This week on Wealth Track, slow and steady wins the race. While the rest of the world races by, award-winning personal finance author Jonathan Clements and leading financial journalist Spencer Jakab show how following a cheap and predictable road can lead to retirement and investment success. Next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management, Global Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholm Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. This week's show is all about money. How to think about it, how to spend it, how to invest it wisely, and how to avoid losing it. Our guests are two highly respected financial journalists who have separately done a tremendous amount of research on these topics, given them a great deal of thought, and have recently written books on different aspects of them which complement each other. One needs no introduction to our audience. He is Jonathan Clements, a WealthTrack regular, and for nearly 20 years, the Getting Going personal finance columnist for the Wall Street Journal. He is the author of 6 personal finance books, including the award-winning Jonathan Clements Money Guide, now available in its 2016 edition. And he has a soon-to-be-published new book called simply, How to Think About Money, which has gotten strong endorsements from the likes of WealthTrack guest John Bogle, founder of Vanguard, and Charles Ellis, a financial thought leader. How to Think About Money in a More Meaningful Way was a prime motivation for doing this program. Another reason came from today's other guest, who is new to WealthTrack, but not to anyone who reads the Wall Street Journal. He is Spencer Jakab, editor and writer for the must-read Heard on the Street column for the Journal, and former writer for its Daily Investing column. He has also written for other publications, including Barron's and the Financial Times. Jakab's first book was just published. It is Heads I Win, Tails I Win, Why Smart Investors Fail, and How to Tilt the Odds in Your Favor. Jakab knows a great deal about smart investors. Before becoming a financial journalist, he was a top-rated stock analyst covering emerging markets at Credit Suisse. He saw firsthand how even well-educated and trained professionals fail at investing. How to avoid their mistakes is part of today's discussion. But I started by asking Jonathan Clements the most basic question: how should I think about money?
Let's say, ask the question, how shouldn't you think about money? Think about the way we were brought up. We were told that money buys happiness. We were told that the goal is to beat the market. We were told that, you know, whoever has the most toys wins, that you want to be the richest family in the neighborhood, that, you know, if you work hard at investing, you'll succeed. All of this is nonsense. And I've come to learn this is nonsense over the 31 years that I spent writing and thinking about money. And, you know, one of the rules that I discuss in my new book is that, you know, if you want to get more happiness out of your dollars, you've really got to be thoughtful about the way that you spend.
Which is one of your major points. The first point is think about spending to buy more happiness. So that's kind of one of your principles, right?
People need to be much more thoughtful about the way they spend money. And what they instinctively tend to do to buy more and more possessions isn't the road to happiness. The road to happiness lies in spending your money on experiences rather than possessions, spending on having good times with friends and family, and also managing your money in such a way that you don't live with constant financial worry. And yet a lot of people manage their finances in such a way that because of all their overspending, because they take on way too much debt, that they end up not enjoying the money they've spent, but suffering a hangover from it.
Another major point is bet on a long life.
Today, you know, we're looking at life expectancies of 9 decades. People, you know, historically have only lived to, you know, age 50 if you were born a century ago. Now we have this much longer life expectancy, and that should change the way we manage our money. Obviously, our investment time horizon is much longer, so that we should think about investing heavily in stocks. Obviously, even upon retirement, we have a very long time horizon at that point, so we should be worried less about dying early in retirement and more about living an awfully long time. And this is the reason you might want to delay Social Security till age 70. It's the reason why you might want to buy an immediate fixed annuity. But I'd like to focus on another aspect of this. If you've got 9 decades and, you know, 70 of those as an adult, you're going to want occasionally to change careers, change passions, change what you strive for. Throughout your life, you want to have a sense of purpose, and you should use your money to design a life for yourself where you can spend your days doing what you want. And so one serious financial implication behind this, and I tell college kids this all the time, when you go out into the workforce, your goal shouldn't be to follow your dreams. Your goal should be go out there and get yourself in great financial shape as early in your adult life as possible. And then later in life, you'll be able to pursue your passions, whatever they are. You'll have the financial flexibility to swap into a career that's perhaps less lucrative, but you may find more fulfilling.
So that is such a contrary idea and contrary to everything that we're told is to follow your bliss, that if in fact you do what you love in your profession, that the, you know, that the money will come. You're saying, you know, let's get reality check here.
Yeah, the reality check is, why in my 20s does pursuing my passion, following my bliss, why is that more important in my 20s than it is in my 50s? I would argue that exactly the opposite is true. When you're in your 20s, a lot of people happily go to work. They work weekends, they do jobs that are drudgery, and yet they enjoy it because the work world is new and exciting.
Right.
When you get to be my age, the work world is not new and exciting. The work world is really a bore, and you start casting around and saying, what is it that I can do with my life that's going to be more fulfilling? And that's why people have midlife crises, and that's why they change careers. And when you get to that point, when you're my age and you're looking to change careers, you want your finances to be in great shape so you have the financial flexibility to change.
And let's talk about getting finances in great shape, and I'm going to bring Spencer in one moment, but your third point is rewire your brain, and you're saying that we are hardwired to fail both as savers and investors.
We have this short-term mentality, which is why we shy away from stocks, and we panic when the market goes down. We tend to believe that we have this short life expectancy, so we claim Social Security early, we shy away from annuities. But the biggest mistake that we make is we're far too focused on consuming today and far too reluctant to put aside money for tomorrow. I mean, I've met thousands of everyday Americans who have accumulated seven-figure portfolios. Often these people are lousy investors. Many times they've had modest salaries, but almost all of them have one attribute in common. They're extremely frugal, otherwise known as cheap. If you want to succeed financially, you've got to have great savings habits. And yet, those great savings habits do not come naturally to us.
Right, delayed gratification. So, Spencer, this is where you come in, and with your new book, which is Heads I Win, Tails I Win, Why Smart Investors Fail, and How to Tilt the Odds in Your Favor. You were a top-ranked Wall Street analyst, and I'm looking at you speaking of what Jonathan has just said. So you probably made a lot more money as an analyst than you're making now as a journalist. So you've actually followed Jonathan's advice. Where's the evidence that smart investors fail?
The evidence is overwhelming that smart investors fail, and smart investors fail more than less smart investors. Less smart people tend to have less money to lose and invest, but you know, if you are intimidated by investing and leave it sitting and don't do very much, you have at least a fighting chance. But if you look at the figures, they are absolutely shocking. I knew that this was the case, but when I looked into it, I was really surprised doing research for the book. First of all, by how badly people do. I mean, I'll give you one example. Let's say that you and I have a great uncle and he leaves us some money. And he says, well, Consuelo, you know, I know you have a show about money, but you know, you weren't an analyst like Spencer. I'm going to put this into index funds, the cheapest index funds possible, 60% stocks, 40% bonds. And Spencer, since you were an analyst, you can't spend the money, but do what you want with it. Go ahead and invest it in whatever you want in funds. If I were the typical investor, as measured by one of these studies, and there have been several studies of investor underperformance, after 30 years, that lump sum, you would have 7 times as much money as I do.
What makes one a bad investor? What are the attributes of investment failure?
The main attribute, the biggest chunk of that underperformance comes from being active, from activity, from being hyperactive. So, and there are many ways to demonstrate this and many ways to look at it. One is, if you look at investors, there's a famous study where they looked at thousands of retail investor accounts, and they stripped out the costs of doing so. So they just looked at what the results were. And they split people into five buckets from most to least active in terms of how often they traded. And it's like in a straight line. The most active fifth, you know, earns 6 percentage points a year less than the less active fifth. And the other shocking thing is that people don't realize this. So people will salt away money and switch to this manager and that trend and 3D printing or put it into Apple.
Right. They're chasing performance. They're chasing the hot, whatever the hot thing is.
All the time.
Right.
And they people just are not wired to do this. I mean, 99.9% of our existence as humans has been, you know, living on the savannah, this kind of short, brutal existence. And
right.
Our minds are wired to survive there. And our minds are wired to fail as investors. I mean, running away from danger, running towards something that's enticing. All that stuff makes us make bad decisions. So activity is absolutely number one thing. And you can do something about it. You can't change the way your brain is wired, unfortunately, but you can build a wall between yourself and your money. You can understand that and be as passive as possible and as mechanical as possible to save yourself big, big money over the years.
So explain how to be as passive as possible and as mechanical as possible. And you're just saying, you know, just be as passive as you can be. How do we do that?
So the best way to do that is not to get carried away. I have a plan. I'm in a, let's say, a target date fund, or I'm rebalancing my portfolio and I'm going to stick with that. And you just need to, even though your emotions are telling you otherwise, you need to be able to stick with that. And if you can't stick with that, then you need to pay someone.
Mm-hmm.
Who will? And you know, paying someone, let's say if you pay a robo-advisor a 0.25 percentage point, or if you pay a human advisor a full percentage point, I personally don't do that. But I think a lot of people, it's a big chunk of your money, actually, to pay someone a percentage point. But it will be worth it if it stops you, if calling that person up and that person is wise and kind of good counsel and tells you, no, don't put everything into 3D printing stocks.
Right.
It's a big mistake.
I mean, Jonathan, is that what you would advocate as well? I mean, the target date fund, some sort of an automatic rebalancing program just to take your emotions out of the process.
No, I think Spencer's absolutely right. I mean, the less decisions you end up making, the better. You want to set up a portfolio, preferably using low-cost index funds, and just let it run. If you trade too much, if you start second-guessing yourself too much, you're going to end up throwing away dollars.
So there is a rebalancing aspect, obviously, depending on what the markets do. But it's infrequent.
And you're being a contrarian. Contrarians,
yes,
are the people who make a lot of money. Let's think about the market, right? It's a zero-sum game. And that's what you have to understand. There's all this wealth that's generated by stocks and bonds and other investments every year. And if we all shared it equally, then you wouldn't, I mean, obviously some people wouldn't save money, and that's a separate problem, but you'd be doing pretty well. People would be, the typical middle-class saver would be hundreds of thousands of dollars wealthier by the time they retired and have a lot less anxiety.
Right,
but that's
if they
not
were
what
in
people
the market.
Do. If they were in the market, yes, and they weren't paying a fortune for funds that are no good.
And that's another point
and
you
services
make is to you know, be cheap.
Cheap
Don't
and lazy.
Pay
cheap and lazy.
Up,
right?
Cheap and lazy.
But this contrarian aspect is very important too, because you are, by rebalancing, I mean, let's take a period like 1996 to 2000. The market was going up on average 28% a year, some years more, some years less. Let's say you decided that your risk tolerance was 60% in stocks and 40% in other stuff. Every year, you'd have more than 60% in stocks at the end of the year. You'd rebalance.
Right.
And then you'd be kicking yourself saying, gosh, I rebalanced. I should have just kept everything
let
in stocks.
Let my winners run is advice that one frequently gets.
And the next 3 years, you would have been kicking yourself for doing that, because then you had three awful years. And what you have to do is understand you're not going to be able to pick the top and the bottom of the market. You cannot. We are just incapable. Anyone who says that they have any sort of a timing mechanism or even a good stock selection mechanism is lying. It's not true. And so automating it as much as possible will save you lots of money in the long run. It'll make you lots of money.
And speaking from your experience too, as a top-ranked Wall Street analyst, so that's so fascinating. Jonathan, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, I think that the problem here is there's a mismatch between our emotional time horizon and our true investment time horizon. I mean, the late 1990s, it was a very difficult period to be rebalancing regularly, selling stocks, and having stocks continue to go up. But the fact is, you know, we're not investing for 2 or 3 years. We're investing for 60 or 70 years. And if we're thinking about our heirs, for a century or more, what happens this year or next year is immaterial. As long as you have enough cash to cover upcoming expenses, what happens to the stock market this year or next year just doesn't matter.
Jonathan, and this entire conversation brings up another aspect of your book, you know, How to Think About Money, is how to think really, really big is one of your points.
Wall Street sells us our financial lives piecemeal. You know, insurance agents are trying to sell us insurance. We've got mutual fund companies that are trying to get us to fund our IRAs. We've got brokerage firms that are trying to get us to trade, credit card companies that want us to carry a balance. But the problem is almost nobody talks about how all these different financial pieces fit together. And as a consequence, we have this world overflowing with irrationality. You know, we have young parents who have a minivan with a low $250 auto deductible, but they don't have any life insurance. Or we have people who have money sitting in a savings account earning 0.1%, who also have a credit card balance that's costing them 20%. You know, people who buy lottery tickets who won't buy stocks because they're afraid of losing money. I mean, this is crazy. And so the question is, how can you get your hands around your entire financial life? And I would argue that the key thing you need to focus on is your paycheck or lack thereof, what academics call your human capital. When we're young, we have what is essentially this huge position in bonds. We've got 40 years of paychecks rolling in. And that frees us up to take on debt. It frees us up to invest heavily in the stock market. It also means that we need to have substantial amounts of life insurance and disability insurance in case we die and we leave our family in the lurch, or we can't work because we have a disability. As we grow older and our paycheck is about to disappear, that's why we have to start thinking about things like reducing the amount of stocks in our portfolio and increasing the amount that we have in bonds. That's why as we approach retirement, we should think about paying down that debt so that we'll be debt-free when we retire.
In fact, though, when you think about retirement, it could be some people are going to, if they retire in their 60s, are going to live as long retired as they are with a paycheck. And so they have to create their own paycheck, and that's where stocks, so the old adage of kind of, I remember Jack Bogle telling me this, you know, whatever your age is what you should be in bonds.
It's still a very reasonable rule of thumb. The one thing people should think about is, you know, if your human capital, your paycheck is so valuable, one of the ways to make the retirement numbers work is to think about working part-time in retirement. That way, you know, you continue to have a steady source of income. But on top of that, and I think this is very important, you also have a reason to get out of bed in the morning. You know, you still have that sense of purpose. And I think that's really critical even after you leave full-time work.
And final point in your book, Jonathan, is to win, don't lose. And this is where Spencer comes in again. Minimize potential subtractions from your wealth.
Remember, the goal isn't to have the largest portfolio possible. Instead, the goal is to have enough money to lead the life that you want. You're not going to get there by trying to beat the market. You're not going to get there by not having the right insurance. You're not going to get there by betting everything on a single stock. If you want to lead the life that you want, what you have to do is focus on avoiding losses. And what I mean is losses big and small. Small losses like the losses to mutual fund expenses, the losses because you have a tax inefficient portfolio, but also the big losses. Losses like betting everything on a few stocks or a single part of the market, or not having the right insurance, not having health insurance, not having disability insurance. Avoiding those big losses and those small losses is the key to winning in the investment markets.
And Spencer, another major point in your book is turning lemons into lemonade. Explain what you mean by that.
Okay, so I look back and, you know, sorted all the data in terms of not just how badly people do, but when, at what times they did badly, what periods cost them the most money. And the surprising thing is, you know, everyone thinks, well, bear markets, of course, that's when I lost a lot of money in the tech crash or during the financial crisis. And of course, you lose money if you're fully exposed to stocks temporarily, and then it comes back. But the time that really, really costs people money is after that, because people get spooked. They take their money out of the market, or take some money out of the market, or they don't put more money into the market when they should through the automatic sort of rebalancing that I'm talking about. And those periods do really well. And it's really surprising. You tell people this, like, are you sure that's right? I'm sure it's right. You look at the 3 months before unemployment peaks. I went back and looked at the last 14 peaks in unemployment. When unemployment rate is going up, that's not good for the economy. Times are bad. People are pessimistic. You know, the headlines are bad. Now, if you look at the stock market return in those three-month periods strung end to end, you made 64% annualized on your money.
If you stayed in the market as the unemployment rate goes up, which means the market's probably going down, if you stayed in the market in those periods,
absolutely,
of peak unemployment.
You made 64% annualized during those periods. So that's, I looked at 14 different peaks. That's 3.5 years strung end to end. You made 7 times your money. I mean, there's no other time when you make money like that. And that is when people are most likely to be either out of the market completely because they got spooked, or underexposed. And if you rebalance regularly, what you're going to have done at some point before that is bought more stocks into the teeth of what looked like a very bad market. I can't tell you when the market will turn around, because no one can, but I can tell you when you miss out on those gains. It's foregone gains it's the market lemons. It's bad periods, but great gains.
And that's
what really costs people.
And the point is, that's why you stay in the market. That's why you're a passive investor and you rebalance, but that's because no one is going to call those right.
Right. I mean, the analogy that I also used was, let's say you're going somewhere with your family on a car trip, right? And MapQuest says, okay, it's going to take 3 hours to get there if you drive X miles per hour, right? And then you're on the interstate for half an hour, and you're like, oh my God, I left my wallet on my kitchen counter. You turn around, you go back, you get it, and you drive back, and it takes you much, much longer. MapQuest was wrong because it didn't anticipate you doing that. But the stock market has a MapQuest too. The stock market's MapQuest takes all that into account because it knows that those reversals are going to happen. So you look at the long-term stock market performance, which is about 9.3% a year over the last several decades, including dividends, it includes all those reversals, includes all those bear markets. So when the market's going forward, the market's back on the interstate going to where you're going to be going, it's going a lot faster than 65 miles an hour. It's going 150 during those really bad periods. And you need to be in the market during those times when it's going 150. Accept the fact that sometimes you're going to forget your wallet and it's going to go back. Bear markets happen and bad things happen, but you got to take the good with the bad.
One investment for a long-term diversified portfolio, Jonathan Clements, what would you have all of us own?
I would buy today's biggest lemon, which is emerging markets, and particularly the Vanguard Emerging Markets Index Fund. The ETF is VWO. It has a svelte 0.15% expense ratio. You don't get much lower than that. And more exciting to me is, the funds have lost a cumulative 22% over the last 5 years. That means you're buying into one of the fastest growing parts of the global economy, and you're getting it, one-fifth off. What can be bad about that?
And you were sitting next to a former emerging markets top-ranked analyst. Spencer Jakab, what would your one investment be for a long-term diversified portfolio? And what do you think about Jonathan's idea?
I don't disagree, because I'm a contrarian. And you should be a contrarian, although my advice won't be that specific. You should buy a fund that, for example, that's a target date fund that has allocations to all those things that regularly rebalance it. So let's say it had foreign stocks as 10% of its holdings and emerging market stocks as 3 or 4% of its holdings. Well, guess what? It would have just bought more emerging markets because those have done awfully. So don't try to be too clever is what I'm saying, but any fund that does that, that's very, very low cost, and you should check the expense ratio, that buys into all those assets and buys more of what just went down, will stand you in good stead over time, definitely.
So the message from both of you is invest by all means, but do it in a passive manner and just rebalance. Thank you both so much for being here. Spencer Jakab, your first time on WealthTrack. It was just terrific to have you on the program.
Me.
And it's always great to welcome Jonathan Clements back to WealthTrack as well. And congratulations, each of you, on your new books.
Thank you, Consuelo.
At the close of every WealthTrack, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's Action Point involves two recommendations. It is read Jonathan Clements' How to Think About Money and Spencer Jakab's Heads I Win, Tails I Win. Clements' brief, thoughtful book is for everyone, young and old, and it's going to help you rethink the role money plays in your life and how to get more satisfaction and security from it. It is a stress reducer. Jakab's book is for investors. It takes you through the sobering research on how and why we sabotage ourselves. It analyzes the good and bad performance of star investors, including WealthTrack guest Bill Miller, and it gives you some excellent advice on how to avoid all too common investment pitfalls and make money instead. Both are easy, interesting, and important reads for building financial security, and you can take them to the beach. Next week, we're going to talk to a global quality growth investor with a really good long-term track record, Harding Loevner's Chief Investment Officer, Simon Hallett. How did Jonathan Clements become so frugal and commonsensical about money? And why did Spencer Jakab leave Wall Street and become a journalist? Go to the extra feature on our website to find out. Also, keep reaching out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Thornburg Investment Management, Active Management Global Perspective, Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholme Foundation.